Cool. Welcome to the Man to Man podcast. I'm your host, Alan the Great. Today we have a father, we have a son, we have a brother, we have a man who's a role model to the entire society who took time today to speak to me, to speak to you about various topics. I've known this man for almost 20 years. 20 years, this man have known each other. We have shared good times and bad times. He's seen me at some of my toughest, roughest moments. Seen me at the down moments in my life, as well as I've seen him at some of his best and his worst moments. We've been there for each other for a long time. So today, this is the first time we actually going to share one of our epic conversations live on camera. We never do this before. Usually we have dope, interesting comments, I mean, conversations about things, but we never do it on camera. So it's a first for everything. Let me welcome y'all today, my brother, my man's right here, my bro, Corey Wilson. How you doing, bro?
Hey, how you doing, bro? Thank you for having me, man.
Yeah, man, we had a lot of technical difficulties today. You know, that's my fault. I should have, like, checked everything before I got started. You know, the setup set up for a whole different situation, and then, you know,
yeah,
things happen. You know how it is.
Good, man, we here now.
Absolutely. So let's jump right into it, bro. Let's jump right into it. So we was having an interesting conversation, and I want to get into that first before we get into all the other things. We was talking about something that happened today. Now, for you guys, this is probably like next week. You know, when I release this episode, you know, you probably already caught up on what we're about to talk about. Excuse me. But we're talking about Chris Brown dropping a diss on Quavo. But also, before we go into that, you told me that we was talking about J. Cole apologizing to Drake and Kendrick Lamar, and you will start to express your emotions and your feelings about that and how it affects hip-hop. Let me talk to me about that, bro.
Okay, so hip-hop's real interesting right now, and if you love hip-hop, then this is like a festival right now. So this all starts with a beef between Drake and Future. So basically, a lot of petty stuff going on. Future feels like Drake doesn't really ride for him like that. You know, Future and Drake had that collab album. He wasn't really feeling the fact that Drake went ahead and did that collab album with 21. It's a lot of fake friend stuff going on. Then Future goes with Metro and they do that song and they get Kendrick Lamar on it. Kendrick, always when he comes out, he wants to assert that he's number one. And if you're a rapper, you know what that means. If you feel you're the best, you always want to say it and you always want to prove it. So that kicks off a whole bunch of beef. J. Cole, who's been saying that he's been number one for the longest, responds with one of the middest of all mid disses back and then immediately apologizes. And how I feel, it's like you apologize for minding your business and somebody walking up and punching you in the face and you go, yo, I'm sorry for whatever I did. I apologize for making you punch me in my face. Before he apologized, before his diss, and everybody even thought his diss was all right, J. Cole was definitely considered one of the GOATs. Even if you don't even listen to J. Cole like that, you don't listen to his albums, he was considered one of the GOATs. But he can't be in no top three conversations ever again after bowing out before Kendrick Lamar even gets a chance to respond. And that's how I feel.
All right, but why do you okay? Let's okay. Why do you feel like he bowed out though? What was the reason for him bowing out?
His reason for bowing out, he says that and I don't listen to J. Cole albums as deeply as J. Cole fans, but the brother has been on a positive kick for a long time. He says that, you know, for his mental health, for his spirit, that he doesn't want to go down that path of beefing and all the things that it brings. And, you know, he says that the audience wants bloodshed. Look, J. Cole is pretty much a conscious rapper with a couple of gun bars. Not even gun bars, but a couple of aggressive bars. Kendrick is not sending nobody after nobody this was 100% going to be a lyrical battle. And J. Cole looked at that smoke and said, "You know what? I don't want none of that." And walked off.
All right, let me ask you something. I'm going to spin this real quick. You know I'm great spin this conversation. You know how I do. I'm looking at it, and you said J. Cole was concerned about his mental health, right? And that was like kind of concerned with that. And I know as men, you know, one of the issues we have, especially as black men, is dealing with our mental health and being comfortable with speaking about it, especially in a public setting, because a lot of times we're made to feel, you know, insecure about talking about that. Like that's taboo in our environment, especially in hip hop. It's seen as a weakness about speaking about your mental health. So like, yo, I don't want to do this because this is going to trouble me mentally. It's seen as a sign of weakness. Is that that's crazy to me that that's the way it's depicted. And I get that hip hop is about, you know, who's the greatest, who's the best. And as men, let's be honest for a second. Testosterone tells us in our mindset we all want to be the king of the hill. Most men want to be king of the hill. We don't want to be, you know what I'm saying, bow down to no other man. Let's just keep it a buck there. And that's how we are as men. But it's also that like component when we talk about the J. Cole Kendrick thing, where both of them are very dope artists, it also reflects on society and us as men in general and how we just can't express ourselves, express our mental health without, you know, being chastised for it, or like, oh man, you're not as great as you was because, you know what I'm saying, you bowed out or you apologized. Like, oh, it's like, how do we explore that dynamic? Like, how do we balance that, bro? Like, what do we
Okay,
do that?
I got an answer for that.
All right, let me hear it.
I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying. And to a big extent, you're right. We've had a lot of off-camera conversations about the mental health of black men, and we can in future podcasts go deeper into that. I don't have a problem with that. But what we can't do. What we can't do is confuse and conflate one thing with another. For the amount of time that I've known you, and we've been brothers, this man has spent his entire time trying to prove, demonstrate, and tell the world that he was that ninja, that guy, that he was hot stuff, the biggest. And then as his career progressed, he spent every single song going, "Nobody can mess with me. I'm number one." And when he was saying that top three line, in his mind, he was saying, "Yeah, we're the big three, but I'm number one." When you see interviews, and he talked about, "Yeah, you know what I mean? Every time I do a feature with somebody, I smoke them." But it's me, like, as it's rap confidence, it's the confidence. And as a rapper, only rappers really get that. Rappers and people who are fans of hip hop super hard understand that kind of confidence. If we're going to talk about mental health, when all of this stuff happened, when people are coming at your neck about things that you said, and you've stood on this for about, let's say 20 years, let's say 15 years, for 15 years, you stood on the fact that you're better and you don't care who it is. And you said, "I don't care who you are, where you from, Cole is the greatest." And then somebody says, "You know what? You've been wolfing all this long. Let's see what you're about." You then can't go after all this amount of time. "You know what? I've got to look after the purity of my spirit, the sanctity of my mind." You can't do that. Hip hop is its own thing. It ain't about the purity or the sanctity of nothing. You know, we don't have to be from New York, from the Mecca, to understand what hip hop is about. We grew up with this thing. We know what this thing is from Kool Moe Dee, LL Cool J, Busy Bee, old school. Old school rap battles from KRS-One to the DJ Mo. I mean, come on, man. Listen, you can't say that you're something for so many years, go unchallenged. And then when somebody says your name, you go, oh, you know what? I just want to make sure that my mental's okay and I protect myself.
So basically you're saying this is like a league of your own with Gina Davis and Tom Hanks. Crying? Yeah. You can't cry in baseball, so you're saying you can't cry in music. But on a bigger scale, I don't even understand the point of all this arguing over who's the best. Well, we already know who should be everybody's top five in hip-hop. Dylon, 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 Dylon. That's it.
Dylon.
That's it. That's the best top five right there is Dylon. And me and you both know that. Dylon, the top five should be everybody's hip-hop list.
He's definitely the greatest, and I'm tired of everybody sleeping on him, personally. And after that, it's Big Chopper. He's in trouble right now.
Yeah, but, listen, I get it, though. Like, there's no, you know what I'm saying? Like, just like basketball, you know, showing signs of weakness, you basically dinner. It's like you in the jungle, you know what I'm saying? You can't, once you're weak, once you show your sign of wounded, then to the whole society, you're dinner, you're food now. We can eat you now. We don't respect you the same no more. It's an interesting perspective as we try and use hip-hop. And I get that hip-hop is a different dynamic than regular life. But at the same time, as you know, you well know this because you're well coursed with hip-hop. Hip-hop is a direct reflection of what we do in society and how we live and how we, you know what I'm saying, how we think of ourselves. Yeah. Not just about how being number one, but how we refer to ourselves. So when I'm talking about, and I'm bringing this back to a matter of being a man, let me just explain this for the audience. What I'm trying to do in directness is showing the reflection that's shown in hip-hop and how people respond to a man for however reason. We can debate that in the comments. Let me know what your thoughts are on J. Cole apologizing, but how that did not that dynamic, excuse me, plays out at with us in society as a man, and can we apologize to another man after we got into a war with him, had war words? Can we do that? Can we have that conversation? We realize in hip-hop, we realize we all, you know, want to be the number one masculine thing, but can we apologize, or is that sign of weakness that shows everybody out there that, yo, it's open season on you. You dinner.
Society-wise, right? Society. Okay. When it comes to black men, I've always told you this. Now I'm going to say it on camera.
Okay.
I always feel like, you know, we're people who have been victimized, stolen from, tortured and abused, and we never got an apology for, you know what, this apology doesn't mean anything, but I'm sorry. I'm sorry that we stole. I'm sorry that we hurt. I'm sorry that we abused. I'm sorry that we lied on you. I'm sorry that we stole your culture. Real healing doesn't start until everybody can start acknowledging all the parts they played. Absolutely. I believe.
Absolutely. But at the same time, when we talk about society, we're going to keep like relating it back to hip hop at this point, but you're right what you're saying. But at the same time, it's like when you look at J. Cole, you look at Kendrick Lamar, you look at hip hop, we're like the only genre of music that I'm aware of. And if I'm wrong, you know, like I said, you're a historian as well as I am. And please correct me on this. We're the only genre of music where we truly attack each other to prove who's better. Like, I don't see that with U2 and the Rolling Stones. Like, I don't see Aerosmith trying to say that, yo, I'm better than, you know, this group. You know what I'm saying?
Well, Prince didn't like Rick James, and Rick James didn't like Prince.
Because Charlie Murphy beat Rick James up. And Prince beat Charlie Murphy in basketball game. I mean, I don't know how you bring that one into the equation, bro.
Rick James.
There's science to it. I wouldn't like Prince either. When Prince
first came out, Rick James was already a thing. And Rick James was huge. Right. Rick James was way bigger than Prince. And then Prince had started opening. Prince is just out on the scene. And they would watch each other's shows. And Rick was beating them in the beginning. Because this is one of the interviews that was done with one of Rick James' band members. Then all of a sudden, Prince became Prince that we all know.
Mm.
And then all of a sudden, the scream started to become louder for Prince. And then it started to become Prince's era. And the next thing you know, the women and the men start dressing a little androgynous. Yep. And, you know, and everybody starts getting on a Prince wave. And then all of a sudden, you know, they used to equate it like this. There used to be way more people in a Rick James party, in the after party, than Prince. Mm-hmm. But when Prince took off, there couldn't be a tumbleweed that would go through Rick James' joint. And Prince's joint was packed. In rock and roll, in blues, in hip-hop, there's always been competition. It's only when it comes to hip-hop we're more braggadocious about it. We're more aggressive and vocal about our dislike for each other.
Let me adjust my opinion just a little bit on that, just to reflect on what you just said. Let me change it just a little bit. Because I don't like, this is the first A I heard about Rick James and Prince. I heard about Michael Jackson and Prince, but I felt like it wasn't so much of an issue there as much as I feel like the media tried to draw a wedge in them with comparing the two, which if you look at them as artists, they're two completely different artists, in my opinion. They're two totally complete artists, both talented as hell, but it's like comparing an apple to an orange. It's not the same. They're not the same type of art, same type of artists, in my opinion. They may seem like they both do rock, but the type of music they did is an issue, is completely different. And this is the issue too, I feel, to change and adjust my argument just a slight. Okay. Black people are normally reflected and forced to go at each other to play King of the Hill. So it's a better argument what I'm talking about as far as that. You know, black people, so when you're talking about Prince and Rick James, that's it. Hip-hop is the same situation. When you got R&B, you're dealing with, okay, who's the queen of R&B? Who's this? Who's that? Black women in rap. It's like this thing where with black people, we're constantly trying to figure out which one of us is the top? Which one's us the top? And more for men than anything. It happens with women, but more for men, we have this issue. And even in society, we play the same issue. Like I said, music in a lot of ways, especially hip hop, you know, relates a lot to the society we live in because it is our CNN. It's our news. You know what I mean? And they're using it now in courtrooms for the YSL case to use as evidence against us. But a lot of time, hip-hop is our news. We express ourselves through our music, our emotions, our feelings, through that That's music. True. But my point is like, we just constantly like, yo, we constantly at each other. And I'm just interested in your perspective of why do you feel like that's a thing where we're just constantly attacking each other?
As far as the black people, you know, the reason of black people being more aggressive towards each other, like as far as competitive wise, I think really is its own thing. And that's connected to a whole thing that's connected to really, to me, that's connected to slavery. Slavery and survival. It's the reason why we have this silliness about skin color. It's the reason why we have this whole thing about, you know, back in the day, dark skin is cool, but if you was light skin, and then, you know, Wesley Snipes came out, now dark skin is cool. It's the same thing about how Africans at one point in time back in the day used to look down on Africans. And then as time progressed, we learned that Africans was looking at African Americans like, y'all ain't us. I don't know which y'all are, but y'all ain't us. And they don't even know the history of what we've been through in America. They don't know, and they don't care. They don't care the fact that we were stolen, a lot of them. Some of them are really intelligent and really apathetic once they learn, but they don't know the history. So they just think that we're just over here, I don't know, living a high life.
Yeah.
They don't get educated. But then again, I love history, so I've educated myself more. But how many people randomly educate themselves on different countries in Africa and, you know, different things they're going through. And that's not a thing we do, but that doesn't excuse them for looking at us and going, oh, you know, y'all ignorant, y'all lazy, y'all, whatever our problems are, there's a lot of systemic stuff going on with why that is. That's not an excuse for us not to get up and change it, but there's a lot of institutions that have been put into place to keep us that way, but they don't understand. So when we go into competition and we go into why people look at each other side-eyed and crazy-eyed, there's a lot of stuff in between that. If I'm going to bring it back to hip-hop,
But this
bring
is go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. I'm sorry, go ahead.
if I'm going to bring it back to hip-hop, it's exactly kind of what you were, you know, insinuating. Hip-hop is a reflection of the people. True hip-hop.
Not
Not the kind that
fake stuff.
record company putting out.
We're not talking about the movie stuff.
We're talking about the true hip-hop. Hip-hop is a reflection of the streets. When back in the day, everywhere you went, it was a different game. Back in the day, every neighborhood, you couldn't even hear on the East Coast. It wasn't just like that in California. Back in the day, if you had a gal that lived over on the East Side and you were from the West Side, there was no going over the East Side to go see her. And you wasn't getting out of there. There wasn't, you know, and we're in Delaware. There was no going to Ellesmere. You wasn't making it out of there. You wasn't making out of West Side. You wasn't going to Little Italy. You wasn't going there. That wasn't happening. And you can change interchange those names with anywhere else in the world and all the different neighborhoods. And that's just the way it was back in the day. Competition has will always be a thing. Hip
No,
hop.
let me step in real quick because I think that's a good point. I want to step in on that because, like you talked about being a student in history, which I am too, that's one of the reasons we connect. And with people, when you talk about Africa and how people don't educate themselves on Africa, we talk about territorial. First of all, facts on that, because if you're from any city, whether it's where we from, Chicago, Philadelphia, LA, anywhere, then you know that this is a fact where, you know what I'm saying, New York, you come into a neighborhood you ain't from to see a girl, you're gonna have problems. I mean, I don't know how it is now, but I know back when we grew up, that was it. You're going to have an issue. And like you said, unless you know somebody in that neighborhood, unless you know somebody, you're going to have issues. You ain't walking out the same way you walked in. You know what I'm saying? You better bring a crew with you and be ready to scrap on that point of it. But the interesting point of that is when we talk about Africa is what a lot of people don't know, Africa was the same exact way. People don't realize Africa was very territorial and there was tribes in Africa who did not get along. So this is not something that started in Western culture. This is not something that just was created here. That's something that came from Africa, that we a mindset that we brought from Africa, where we had different tribes that didn't get along and
Yeah, you're
still
right
don't
about
get along. And if you want, for those people who are too lazy to look up history, and we're not making this about a history lesson, but if you're too lazy to look up history, I think the movie's called Hotel Rwanda. Go check out Hotel Rwanda. You know, it's a very deep movie. It's based on true facts of something that incident that was real that happened in Africa. And it's talking about two different tribes who were beefing at the time and how much genocide happened to Africa. So to really get the information, you don't. It's not like back in the day where we had to read the encyclopedia, go to the library. It's literally right there for you people to really truly understand, you know, the dynamics of how we act and how we, you know, treat each other and the issues that we have with each other. So I completely agree with you, and I just had to chime in real quick to state that real quick.
You're right about that. Africa is one. Africa is a big, beautiful country with a lot of problems, with a lot of different tribes that have different ways of thinking. But I can't charge Africa with that because no matter how much they think we're different, I'm still an African American. We can charge that to America. 'Cause
Which part? Which part?
Democrats and Republicans,
But which part you mean you can't charge it to Africa? You gotta
I
charge
can't
it to
charge. I can't charge Africa with how wrong their tribalism is wrong without charging everybody because America is very much a clique. Like poor, it's like the rich versus the poor, the Democrat versus the Republican, and you would think that America would have more unity, but when you see the way that the parties are supposed to act in the best interest of the people,
True.
what you usually end up finding is that the parties act in the best interest of the party. It shouldn't be that if you're a Democrat and you see, even though the Republicans have done historically done some evil stuff, but so are the Democrats, it shouldn't be that you can't agree with some of the things a Republican says, especially if they're doing their best to try to serve the people, but they've turned into cliques, they've turned into gangs. It's about the Republican gang and the Democrat gang. And you can see wrong on both sides. You can see hypocrisy on both sides. There are very, you can change the name. They are very much their own tribes. They are very much beefing and they very much have it out for each other. They're no different than gangs in any other part of the country. They're only gangs that run the government and have money, but they're gangs. They're 100% gangs.
Yeah, can I disagree with you on that? All right, can I disagree with you on that and
Sure.
get my
Again.
input on that? So how I look at the Republican and for the people, we're if we seem like we're all over the place, this is the conversations me and my brother have, you know what I mean? And this is why we have these conversations now on camera. And I hope you're able to keep up with this conversation because this is truly a man-to-man conversation right here. And I hope you learn something and take it from this. So my breakdown of this is when we look at the Republican Democrat Party, because I was talking to my wife about this a few weeks ago. I said, see, we focus on the Democrats and Republicans on their pull. The Republicans pull you one way, Democrats pulling you one way. At least that's how another way is how it seems.
Okay.
Reality of the situation, and you give me your opinion on this, is it's not about that at all. We look at the brackets in this country. You got rich, middle class, poor. Okay? There's no such thing as a freaking middle class, first of all. The reality is the rich people are trying to force with the people they put in the bracket of middle class against the poor people to continue to fight against each other. The Democrats don't give a damn about you. They don't give a damn about me. Guess what? The Republicans don't give a damn about you. They don't give a damn about me. Because you got some white people who live just as poor as some of us do, living out in the hills, struggling to make it, who
That's true.
support the Republicans. And guess what? The Republicans sit there and feed them crap, kiss their babies just like the Democrats do us, and don't give two damns about us. Because once the election's over, the reality of the situation is the only people they're really interested in helping is the people that can help them. They're trying to keep the wealthy wealthy, the poor poor. And the way they keep everything rolling, everything going in this country is by keeping us fighting against each other. Now, I'm not saying racism is not real, because racism is very real in this country. And we can go into that, and that's a whole another subject and a whole another conversation all in itself. Racism, very real. In every aspect of your life, you can see racism, and I can break that shit down for you. Pardon my French. The interesting thing about this with the Democrat Republican thing is they got us forcing, like, yo, you should vote Democrat. You should vote Republican. Well, we're looking at it like you just said. You made a valid point. You said they should be acting on behalf of the people. Which side is acting on behalf of the people? Like, really, what side is we acting on behalf of the people? Because we sit here walking the streets and you see people homeless. But we see money going to Ukraine. We see money going to Israel. You're not, and you start to say, well, why are they not giving the money to the poor and they send it over there? Because I keep hearing people say that. Let me break it down for you, people. Because it's called investing into your interest. What is your interest? See, what happens over Israel affects the financial stability of this country. What happens in Iran, these other countries, in Ukraine affects the balance of someone's wallet, and that's truly what they're depending on. What happens on the streets of America, whether you sitting there can't feed your kids, don't really affect the rich. It don't change their pockets that you can't feed your kids. It don't. And when it starts to, you just look at the stimulus. Why do you think they gave you a stimulus? You think they gave you a stimulus because they were trying to be beneficial because they felt that you were starving? No, that was an interest loan that they just didn't tell you about the interest. Why do you think inflation is so high right now to pay back the loan from the stimulus? Why they gave you a stimulus was because they needed you to spend money. People were sitting home. Nobody was traveling. Nobody was spending money. All right, let me inject this money into you because I know now you got extra money. Nobody taught you about money. You're going to go spend it. You're going to go spend it, which means you're injecting money into the economy, which is going to eventually go into these rich people's pocket. The truth of the matter, when I look at the Republican Democrat Party, I don't see two different parties. I see the same party that's having backdoor meetings, having conversations, already choosing who's going to be the president, and sit there talking about how they can keep us fighting against each other, how they can keep us divided, how they can keep us, you know what I'm saying, me hating you, you hating me, and us sitting there not realizing, like, yo, we both in the same damn boat with the same damn hole that's sinking, and they sitting on a damn yacht, and we sitting there mad at each other. The Republicans on that yacht, Democrats on that yacht. Me and you sitting there arguing each other. We don't like each other because I'm a Democrat, you're a Republican, but we sitting here sitting in the same damn boat with the same hole sinking, and neither one of them is throwing us a life raft. That's the breakdown of the reality of the situation. And when you look at a lot of the gangs and the tribal activity that's in our neighborhoods and stuff, the reality is why I break it down. I say it's from Africa is this. When you look at Bloods and Crips, and a lot of people, again, don't know the history of these gangs, they were not created to sit there and kill each other. The truth about Bloods and Crips, they were created, these gangs were created to protect the black people in these LA neighborhoods, in Compton, in Watts, was to protect them from police, was to police their own neighborhoods. That was the true reason for them creating these gangs in Chicago, creating gangs, protect the neighborhood from police activity, police abuse, start to police our own neighborhoods. Over time, this transitioned into something where it stopped being about protecting neighborhood and about fighting other people while we try to maintain territory. Now, you look at, you know, some of the tribal areas in Africa, it was similar situation. You want control of this neighborhood. You want control of this territory, protect your people by wiping out the other people. And this is where we are with this situation, you know, in this country. And like I said, this country is very, very racist. And please, people, wherever you are out there, please don't tell me this country is not racist. This is one of the most racist countries on earth right here, despite the fact that you have rich billionaire black men, Latino men, Asian men, it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, when you look at the root of this country, in the base of this country, in the core of this country, you already know racism fuels this country as it always has. I'm sorry, Corey, I just went on my whole, you
I
know.
mean, since I got this platform, since I got this platform, this chance to speak on your platform, and thank you for that again. I just want to say this. And no offense to, as a black man, I've got to say this. No offense to the people that are suffering in the world and the wars going on in the world. And, you know, God rest and God bless the people who are suffering unjustly. This is not against them. But to our government and for our people, I want to understand why. Because I'm not an economist, okay? And my grade in political science was okay. It might have not been a super A plus plus plus. But I definitely remember passing that class, you know, and I didn't go on into academia and, you know, become scholarly that way. But I want to understand why that whether, you know, let's step away from race for a minute. Now, this is a pure American sentiment. And usually I'm only making pro-black sentiments, but this is a pure American sentiment. Why do we have so much money and resources, and we can enact so many programs and policies for people in other countries? But if me, you, or somebody that's watching this right now, if they just go down to the, if they just go downtown, it doesn't matter which, it doesn't matter, it doesn't even matter which state they're in. It really doesn't matter. If they're in America, they're going to see homelessness at a level that they've never seen. Homelessness at an alarming rate. You can't even safely walk in different parts of your town because the homelessness is so crazy. And nothing against the homeless. But why do we have so many money, so many programs? We can give out debit cards to people coming to the country. We can have all these people, but there's people who can't get housing, who can't get food, who can't get... Now, I understand that America has this, oh, well, you should be able to take care of yourself type of attitude. But if we can give so much to the world, trillions and billions, why are there Americans starving, dying, and shivering cold on the streets as we speak in every city of America? Now, that doesn't make sense to me. And I pay taxes.
It's a well-put sentiment, and that's some answers that we definitely need to know in America. Answer that question one day for not only this brother, but for me and all the brothers and sisters who are out there right now, no matter your race, your culture, why that we have so many people that's homeless and starving? Why is it okay for so many children to be starving in a country that has so much fortune? I want to flip the script a little bit because we talked about hip hop, we jumped into politics. I want to talk into a subject that I don't have much experience or knowledge of, but you do. So now I want to pick your brain. If that's okay, can I pick your brain a little bit, brother?
Absolutely. All
right, let's do it. So I've been married to my wife 15 years, been with my wife almost 20 years, almost as long as me and you known each other. You know, you've been at my wedding. Me and you were cool and friends before when I met my wife. So you've been there for the whole entire time. So you know, I've been married for a long time. So the things I'm getting at with this is I haven't dated in this environment at all. Okay, people, I have no experience with dating in this environment, in this culture right now. And I hear all kinds of horror stories from everybody, from men and women. This is Man to Man podcast, so I need to talk to a man. I gotta talk to my brother right here, and I gotta pick his brain on this. Is it really that bad out here, brother?
Yeah, you know what? I'm gonna start this off by being controversial. God rest the goat, Kevin Samuels. I'm automatically going to turn a lot of people. You know, this ain't even no red pill stuff.
But look, you know it's going to get bad when you guys start preferencing your comments before you even make them. You know it's going to get rough.
that's going to rub a lot of people the wrong way. And I'm not going to go back and forth with people about what he was or what he wasn't, because the man is dead. But what I will say is what Kevin Samuels did do was he made men realize that their thoughts and their feelings mattered too. And that if you were a 9-to-5 guy, you didn't have to make $100,000 a year and get talked down to for not making that. That if you was a manager of Mickey D's or if you was a tax-paying guy throwing trash, doing the best to take care of your family, that there was nothing wrong with that. Kevin Samuels stood up for men like that. Kevin Samuels made sure that men also took accountability and they got up off their butts and they had something to contribute. But if you wanted to talk that high-class stuff, he had that conversation for you. But he didn't let you crap on everyday 9-to-5 men. And he was quick to tell a woman, hey, you know, you're not ready for that bracket. You just need to get yourself a regular guy and be happy. So, you know, God rest him. I don't care how anybody feels about that. The dating market obviously is trash. It's garbage. That's not to say about the people. There's still good people out here. I'm recently engaged to a very beautiful woman that I'm in love with. But before that, you know how they say, you know, you got to kiss a couple of frogs. Well, I definitely dove into a swamp with my lips, and I didn't hit every tadpole on the way down and back up. It is rough out here. And the reason why it's rough out here is Delusion. Women want every man to make money like he's in the top 5%. He's got to have, you know, 100,000, six figure, this, that, and the other. He's got to be able to take care of me. He's got to do this. He's got to do that. Not all women. There's a lot of good women out there, but there's a lot of Meg Thee Stallion, Sexy Red, Cardi B listening. They listen to all these songs that steer them wrong, yet behind closed doors, these women are taking care of whatever man they're with, and they're doing all the feminine stuff. But when you listen to all that City Girl stuff, it's, you know, F him, get his money, that he's got to do this. I'm not with that. They popping that fly stuff, but that fly stuff ain't how you get a husband, keep a husband, or maintain a healthy relationship. Men have been misogynistic in music since the dawn of time, but those men don't stay in relationships. Anybody who's married does not talk to his wife like that. You know, he does not treat his wife like that. You might listen to the music, but that's not your mentality. But there's a lot of women that buy into this. It's a me, me, me attitude, and a man doesn't reach these weird qualifications, and they end up hitting 40 or whatever, and, you know, they meet the wall, and the next thing you know, it's, you know, well, maybe I should have been a little more easy on my consider. It's nothing wrong with having your own preferences. It's nothing wrong with having a man that's going to bring some security in your life and be a good dude for you. But the man does not have to be one of the Rothschilds to do it.
That's an interesting perspective that you put. You made a lot of great points in an interesting perspective. Like, we keep going back to hip hop, and this, like I said, it's the man to man. We're going to talk about things and how hip hop is a direct reflection on society, but how also society sometimes attempts to mirror hip hop in a way that is not, you know, properly. It's not reality. It doesn't make sense a lot of times. Like you said, you have some women who listen to the Sexy Reds, they listen to the Meg Thee Stallions, and who want to try to perform like that. You even had Trina one time come on the Breakfast Club and talk about how men that she was dating wanted Trina on the album. She's like, yo, I'm not that woman in real life. That's album. That's art. That's not me. You want me to be the person on an album, that's not reality. That's not who I am. But a lot of times that happens. But it's an interesting perspective, because we look at how the women talk now, but how often do we look at how the men always objectified women throughout the history of hip hop, and how they express themselves, and how we, you know, had expectations of a woman in a relationship? Are we equally as guilty as men for the subjection that we have done to women throughout the years of hip hop?
Okay, you gave me a good one. We're guilty of the misogyny. We are. We're guilty of trying to steer each other wrong in music. But the difference is that okay, we have a disconnect when it comes to some music. Let's take Future, for example.
Okay.
Future will talk about a lot of drugs in his album or in his music. And then a lot of kids will try a lot of drugs. Then Future, and, you know, nothing against Future, but he said this himself. He's on record at stating this, that he doesn't do any drugs. He doesn't do any drugs. But he raps about how the drugs makes him feel and cool. I've rapped before. So every rapper at some point, in whether you're a baby rapper, you're just starting out, you've rapped, if especially in your hood, you didn't have the gun bars, you didn't have any guns. At some point you might have got them, but when you first started out, you might have rapped about, oh, you know, my car or my BMW, my Mercedes or whatever. And you definitely had a hoopty. You never had a Mercedes. But, you know, it's this kind of a hip-hop-ish thing. You know, Rick Ross is the biggest rap cap artist in history. You know what I mean?
Hold on, man. Hold on. Rick Ross is the rapper who, no matter what he doing, even when he do a diss record, you know what I mean? He make you like feel like you just popped the bottle of champagne when you bought that diss record. I get that he might not be. I told you that actually. Thinking back to it, I remember sitting in your living room with you and your mom watching Rick Ross every day hustling. Let me see if you remember this conversation. And I said to you, "Yo, that nigga don't really live that life." And you was like, "Yo, man, how do you know that?" I said, "I can tell by the way he rapping and stuff he's saying. That nigga ain't never sold a drug in his life. He never sold a drug in his life. Rick Ross ain't lived that life. I'm telling you." And this is before 50 Cent brought out the CO picture and all that. I remember
You know
telling you,
what?
like, "Yo, he never lived that life."
I actually remember that. I actually remember you saying that. And I remember me and mom being there, mom being hyped about the video because she just loves hip hop for the reason. You going, he ain't never really do that. And me going, how do you know that? I remember that. But you know, it turns out, you know, I always try to tell you that you're wrong, but it turns out that you were right because he lived none of that. He's talking about the life of Freeway Ricky Ross, a man that is alive. He is currently alive and that was really back in the day doing that and living that and did his time like a man. And he won't even give the man his name back.
No.
He won't even stop talking about the man's lifestyle. Talk about, I know Noriega, he owes me 100 favors. When has Rick Ross, the correctional officer, ever met
Miles
Noriega?
Noriega.
When you were making sure the prisoners did not get in the fights. I don't have anything against Rick Ross. Rick Ross makes really great music. But once again, if we're talking about hip hop purity, it's not. Hip hop is so fake nowadays, because back in the day, we were expecting you to live the life that you were talking about. We were expecting you. You know who personifies living the life they were talking about? Styles P. Styles P, the rapper, is exactly who you get in real life. You already know one of my personal favorites of all time.
All right,
DMX.
oh man, I got an interesting story about that. You know what? I'm gonna save that story. I'm gonna save that story for next time you come on. You know exactly what I'm talking about with the DMX story.
DMX. That was my guy, man. DMX for his greatness, for his flaws. DMX was DMX on record, in real life. What he talked about, he did. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to rap about being a killer, but like when DMX talked about running down on you with a dog talking about give that up, that was real.
That's true. That's
That
true.
was 100% real. So I mean, if you're a nerd and you talk about, yo, man, look, I fix these computers better than anybody, I'm number one, do that. But don't, it's this culture of, you know, coming back to my main point, the Rick Ross, oh, drug selling, the future, oh, doing drugs, that done evolved now into a lot of music to where kids then listen to that. Now they're drugged out and they're killers and they're rapping about that and they're rapping about all the money they got. And the younger kids are listening to that. And now they want to be drugged out killers. Like being drugged out killers is the thing to be. I know that some people in their neighborhoods don't have a choice, but there's a lot of people who do have choices. They could have been lawyers, doctors, media people, fixed computers, whatever. Owned a Denny's. I don't really care what it is, but they listen to this music and they automatically shoot to Let Me Be Thugged Out. And it's crazy because the people and the other half of the people that are rapping about it don't do drugs and they've never been thugged out. They've never been in jail. They've never been in trouble. And the other people that are doing it were misled by people that never did it. It's a weird cycle in hip hop that's having real world effect on our children and our young girls. Flipping over to the female side, you got all this, not trying to, I know how YouTube works, so I'm not trying to cuss on your platform. We have all this Jezebel, Whore of Babylon talk, right? Mm-hmm. In music for women who experiences maybe like that, maybe not like that. They don't really care. But they're presenting that kind of music to women, and women have all these baller ass expectations that they put on normal men. It's a normal guy that might love you to death, but you look at him, and you look at his car, and you look at his clothes, and it's not Versace or Balenciaga. He's not driving the newest or the latest. He's just a hardworking guy trying to put himself through college. Maybe he's just trying to work a couple of jobs and hold it down. But because of music, there's an unrealistic standard of what men are supposed to be that women believe to be true and they vibe to it. So when a real man comes into your life, you look at him and you automatically call him a bum. That man then goes, you know what? F these women. He entered his villain era and he goes, you know what? I'm going to treat them all the same. And he's just going through women and he's not giving nobody a chance because he had his little feelings hurt. And then he goes and hurts somebody and she goes and hurts somebody. And then nobody really understands each other. And the date market is trash. That's how it went, Miles.
Okay, so we're going to end this. I know we're running out of time, so we're going to end this. I got two questions left. I'm giving two quick answers on this. All right. First question is, based on the conversation we had, all the dialogue back and forth, you know, our perspectives and opinions and all the negligence and all the interesting dynamics of hip-hop and how it transformed into what it is today, do you feel like hip-hop has become a negative connotation on the youth? Do you think that hip-hop has become something that has caused the youth to do a downturn in their lives and become something that beyond CNN, beyond just reflecting what we see in the streets, to creating little people and women and men to have an unrealistic imagination about life?
That's a good question. But you know what? I'm going to give you a real KRS-One answer. Not only do I believe this is something that he would say, this is something that I actually believe myself. Hip-hop itself is innocent. Mm-hmm. It's a tool. You can pick up a gun and you can protect your house and your family from the burglar breaking in, or you could be mentally ill and you can go out and do stuff in public you're not supposed to do, or you could just be of perfect sound mind and just be evil in spirit and go commit a bunch of crimes and say, I'm going to get this money and I don't care how I get it, who I get it from. That same gun can be used multiple ways. It can be used to save in the hands of a police officer. It stops an abuser from killing his wife or his girlfriend. Mm. In the hands of a criminal, it can take your life. It can harm your family. It can, you know, take the life of an innocent child playing on the street. So it really depends on whose hands it's in. Really? So, yeah, really? In certain hands, it's very dangerous and it's very poisonous. And the world as a whole is gravitating towards slutty, poisonous energy. But hip hop itself is innocent, because if everybody was on some old common sense J. Cole, I want to heal the world music, then hip hop would be that. But it's like when Childish Gambino came out with This Is America, And everybody was on that, and everybody was analyzing it, and everybody was studying it. I mean, conscious music can be a thing, but we have to want it to be. And right now, conscious music doesn't always have the best beat, so we go to the toxic stuff because, they got Metro Boomin and, the Neptunes and all that, and they're who's there, I'm just naming random beat makers. There's newer people than that. London on the Track, all that, whatever. Just name who. That's that, and the only beats they're making for is people that's talking about killing you to death and making money. But it can be whatever we want it to be, I believe.
Okay, I'm gonna let you go on this question right here. This is a question
Okay.
that I know a lot of females gonna want to know, and a lot of men need to know. So, as you mentioned, you have recently been engaged to a beautiful woman. You're about to get married.
Yeah.
What advice would you give to a man? This is a two-part question. Okay, first,
Okay.
what advice would you give to a man who's out here courting a woman, trying to establish that relationship, find that happily ever after, find that person like you have found? Second
All right.
part is, what would you tell a woman to do to prepare herself for that great man?
For both of them. For the man and woman, heal. It all starts with healing. No two people's stories are alike. Whatever you went through, whatever you've been through in your life, when you want to show up to a person in a relationship, you want to show up, I believe, as your most healed version. I'm not saying perfect. You know, nobody's ever born perfect. And if you're looking for a perfection, you'll be alone for the rest of your life. Don't seek perfection in anybody. You're looking for the most healed version of yourself, and you're looking for the most healed people to interact with. I had a woman right before this one who couldn't get over the different traumas in her life, i.e., baggage of different sorts, or something that a baby father of hers had, like had did to her, and that pain and the stuff that he did, it lived with her. And because it lived with her, it was with her every day, daily. And I was about to say unfortunately, but no, fortunate for me, it didn't work out. But then I met this woman who went through something just as bad, just as equally as bad. But whatever healing she did, I don't know if she talked to a therapist. I don't know if she went to church a lot, but her level of healing in dealing with what she dealt with allowed for a healed me and a healed her to have healthy, healed conversations. In the relationship that I have with my woman, I call her my wife because we're getting married soon, but I go off of Jewish wedding traditions, like, when you're engaged, Mary and Joseph in the Bible were considered husband and wife, espoused. I could kick all types of stuff to people, but what I'm trying to say is my wife. We have a lot of heel conversations. I tell her everything, good things, bad things. Things that I were insecure about, things that had bothered me, things that I hope to do, that I want to do. If there was any kind of advice that I could give you, is get you somebody that you can have those conversations with and that don't judge you, don't keep an account of it in a bad way to and look to like, I'm gonna stick the knife in his back one day if this all goes wrong. Look to have those conversations with somebody to where y'all can just Like if it's a good day, you can have that conversation. If it's bad, if you felt a little insecure today, if you felt a little under weather, if you felt like you were on top of the world, that person that I believe that you can have those everything conversations with, and she's always in your corner, good, bad, or indifferent, that's what you look for. And you want to look for somebody healed. They're not stuck up on an old boyfriend or with, baby father number one or two did. And I'm not shitting on baby single moms. I'm just saying what baby dad one or two did, or what the ex did, or what the ex-husband did and who he cheated with. You want somebody who'd be like, yo, you know what? I went through some terrible things. This is what I've been through, but I'm ready for something in the future. Maybe it's with you, maybe it's not, but this is where I'm at. I think that's what you should shoot for.
There you have it, people. It's great advice, very great advice from a man who has found happiness in, very trying times when it comes to relationships. Corey, I
Yeah.
want to thank you so much for your time and for being a role model to not only, to the young people who encounter, but to all the people who are watching this, whether it's women, men, future men, young boys, whoever's watching this. Thank you for showing them with an example of what being a man is, but also for sharing your perspective on man, your perspective on music, your perspective on culture, your perspective on politics, as well as tribal environments on gang structure. I want to thank you so much for talking to me so much about hip hop, even educate me on some of the subjects. I want to thank you for being here on the show. We definitely need to have you back because there's so much more that we need to talk about. There's so much more that we can talk about. We haven't even scratched the surface of all the things we want to, but unfortunately, time restraints kind of keep us from going into it. But we're definitely going to have Corey back on Man to Man because this is not where the conversation ends. This is just the beginning of a much longer, much more detailed conversation that we're going to have in the future for you, the people who are out there. Remember to continue to leave your comments below to let Corey know whether you agree, disagree, or even disagree or agree with my perspective. And it's not about agreeing and disagreeing. Even if you learn something, let Corey know how great of a man he is. Let him know how much of a motivation, how much he inspired you to the ladies out there. Hopefully that, seeing this man, how he found love, that that there is good men out there. For the men out there, just realize and listen to this man's story about healing. An important thing for all of us, and that's including me, is we need to heal. Heal from past traumas. Heal from all the past experiences we have. Heal from that last relationship and don't take it into your next relationship. Don't walk into something that you're not prepared for. Walk into your greatness when you're ready to actually live in your greatness. And that's the advice I'm going to give to you from one role model to another role model. Corey, was there one last thing you need to say before we sign off?
Nah, man, I like the way you ended it off, man. That was real sweet, man.
All right, bro. Appreciate you, man. Respect to you, Always love for you, bro. I call you my brother. You're my brother. Like I said, known you for over 20 years. Been through a
Yeah.
lot together, a lot of great conversations, man. I do truly appreciate you sitting down, giving me this time, man. I know you're a very busy man. You got a lot to get to. So thank you so much for giving me this time to talk to me, bro. And I'm going to catch back up with you. And I hope that you come back on the Man to Man podcast so we can continue to have these great dialogue. Until next time, people, remember to like, comment, subscribe to my channel, and ring those bells so you get notifications when new episodes are coming out. We have another great episode for you next week of the Man to Man podcast. Trust me, you don't want to miss this conversation. Just like this conversation was epic, the next one's going to be epic as well. So you don't want to miss the next conversation. Watch this show, share it with a friend. Corey, you want to leave before we go real quick? Do you want to leave people your Facebook, Instagram in case they want to contact you or have any additional questions or need additional advice?
No, this time right now, no. I just want to say thank you for letting me on here. I'll definitely be back on here. I can give that the next time. And I just want to say that I had a great time, man. And I would love to talk about much more at another time, man, but I had a great time.
Awesome. With that said, I want to thank all you for watching. Thank all you for being here. And to all the intelligent men and women who are out there, just remember one thing: you are a role model. Until next time, peace.